Okay, everyone. Welcome to our closing keynote. We are the network. We're just going to go ahead and get started here. Probably some people will drift in. But I'd like to encourage a couple of our stragglers in the back strongly, if you would be willing. Come on up. If you feel like you're towards the back of the room, or you're just coming in, come on in. There's a lot of us on stage here. We want to see your faces and your eyes and your smiles, and we can have a fairly intimate opportunity here to talk. I am so excited about this closing session, and I'm so excited about today. I'm Philip Winn. I'm the director of Parks in Place at the San Francisco Parks Alliance, and really, really glad to see everybody that's up on stage here with me today and all of you out in the audience to talk about the extraordinary power of community-based stewards of public space. So if I can get my technology to work here, come on. There we go. I just want to take a couple of minutes to talk to you about this work before we hear from 8 really diverse and amazing community-based projects that are represented by the folks who are up here on stage with me. So the stated mission of the San Francisco Parks Alliance is that we partner with communities and public agencies to create, sustain, and advocate for parks and public spaces that welcome and belong to everyone, which, you know, I hope is a mission that we really all collectively feel like is aligned for us and we can get behind. But I wanted to take a second to kind of interrogate this and think about what does this really mean and how does it really happen? And I think when we think about parks and public spaces in San Francisco, there's a tendency to think about this extraordinary, big, beautiful park that we're all in today. But as I've been thinking about that, and I was looking at the image on this slide, and I was thinking about these stewards and how they really link into a history of stewardship of public space that's very, very long. We've heard from multiple presenters today about how the indigenous peoples who held this land and never ceded it were extraordinary and innovative stewards of public space throughout the Bay Area in the way that they managed this landscape and the way that they worked collaboratively with this landscape for it to meet their needs and had a deep respect for this landscape and the natural world and a deep relationship with it. And I think anybody who was in the last panel about nature prescriptions, it still has a lot of that energy resonating for them in the room and thinking about just how that deep relationship can be. You know, moving a little bit closer to the present day, this park itself was created by extraordinary visionary stewards of public space in the 19th century. People who saw a dunescape and imagined a different environment that could support this city and the future of the city in a new way, and made decisions that would impact people generations away from them, made decisions about us right now in the 1850s and 1860s with a kind of leadership and forethought about the future that we desperately need now as we face the climate crisis that's upon us. And so, you know, the next thing that I thought about when I was looking at this slide, and I love Golden Gate Park, but was to make sure that we remind ourselves about just how rich and diverse the public realm is in San Francisco. And to remind all of us that when we talk about this organization, of which we're all a part, that we're working throughout every single kind of public space in San Francisco. So we're working in Golden Gate Park through our community partner network, through our deep relationship with the Rec and Park Department, through our direct engagement with the citizens of San Francisco and their direct support of this incredible work. But we're also working on the streets in SoMa with community groups and neighbors, turning challenging alleyways into places for the expression of arts and culture and the voice of the community. We're working in natural habitats like Mount Sutro, which we just heard about, where, you know, where there's an intentionality and a respect for trying to bring the native plants back into an environment that's full of invasives and creating a place that's a real respite and extraordinarily different than that street in SoMa that we were just looking at, but of, I think, equal value in many ways for our city. We're creating true, active, interesting, diverse community gathering spaces like Playland in the Outer Sunset, which sits just a block away from the Far Out West Community Garden that we'll be hearing about, working directly with youth to make sure that their voice is prioritized when we're creating public spaces and when we're creating the many, many town squares that a city like San Francisco needs to survive and thrive and to have the social connections that we all need to face the multiple crises that are ahead of us. We're working with partners like Northridge Community Garden in the Bayview, in the center of a high level of disinvestment in public housing where the resources, the support, and the hope that we all deserve are sometimes in short supply, but where projects like this are a beacon, again, for youth in particular, to learn about the natural world, to learn important skills, and to be more closely connected with their own community through taking care of another living thing. And bringing it all the way back to Golden Gate Park, you know, when we look at a huge destination park like this, one that's famous throughout the country and really throughout the world, there's a tendency to think that all of this beauty and activity and service is delivered by city government. The reality is that it's not. We have multiple community partner network groups who are located within Golden Gate Park. This is an area that's stewarded by the Friends of Oak Woodlands. And again, what we're talking about here is a deep partnership between all sectors of society to make public spaces in a public realm in San Francisco that truly works for everyone. And I personally think that's the only way we get there. We don't get there with an infinitely funded government. There's actually something that's of true value when we figure out ways for all the different segments of society to have a place at the table and to have a voice in the conversation and to have a way to contribute to what's happening. So with that in mind, I want to turn to how this work actually happens. It happens through community-based stewards like the ones I'm sharing this stage with, through passionate people who wake up in the morning and care about a particular place in San Francisco and want to make it work better for themselves and their neighbors and hopefully have better clickers than I do. And so I think you can see in these extraordinary portraits, which I hope you've seen some of in the gallery today, the energy of the members of our community partner network and others who do this critical work every day. And I think that when you move through San Francisco, you really, whether you're aware of it or not, are picking up on this kind of energy, that you're in a place where individuals and groups of neighbors really care about the public spaces around them and really want to search for ways to engage with them and to have their own shared visions of what they want to see and what they need around them expressed in the public realm. And that's really what our entire, come on, clicker. man, this thing. I'm a little worried for you guys, you're gonna have to click hard. but we're gonna get to the main event in a couple of minutes here, which is we're gonna have the opportunity to hear from these eight extraordinary groups about the unique projects that they're leading. But before we do that, as I said, the way that we make great things happen in the public realm is through partnership. It's about bringing government, nonprofits, philanthropy, community members, and others all together to create the best possible outcomes. And here to speak a little bit about a few of the projects that are happening in his district and to show his support for the work that we're doing here today is, if I can get his attention, is Supervisor Asha Safai, who's gonna come up and join us for a few minutes on stage.
To start speaking?
Yeah, go for it.
Well, hey, good afternoon, everyone. It's really nice to see all these dedicated park advocates. I am so happy to be here. I'm so happy to be back in person and not be on a Zoom call and not be able to see anybody or online. First wanted to say thank you to the Parks Alliance for over their over 50 years of advocacy here in San Francisco. Let's give it up for Drew Becker and his leadership. They've done a tremendous job, and I just want to highlight a few of the groups that I'm here today with that are getting honored. I see one of the Lindas giving me a face, but the Lindas are in the house. Friends of the Jerry Garcia Amphitheater, thank you for all your tremendous work. Friends of Minnie and Lovey Rec Center, thank you for all your tremendous work, and Dr. Honeycutt. And then Friends of the Oh My Mini Parks, Johanna, and all the tremendous work that she is doing. It's a newer form group. And all the help and support that the Parks Alliance is giving to them. I just want to say that without advocates, without people and their energy, without their ideas, without their dedication, we would never be able to achieve what we've been able to achieve in our parks in San Francisco, specifically in my district. There's been so much energy put into the renovation of the amphitheater and the ability to have now even larger scale concert, neighborhood concerts. Thank you again to the Parks Alliance and the work that they've done with Noise Pop. And I want to give this Linda credit for first putting Noise Pop in my ear, and then we have been able to make that a reality. We're going to have some phenomenal series. We're calling it Due South, very similar to a series that they do in a place called Stern Grove. I don't know if you guys have heard of it, but just kidding. But it is a phenomenal series. And then there's Shakespeare in the Park. There's all types of neighborhood activities there. And then Friends of the Minnie and Lovey Rec Center and Dr. Honeycutt and the garden that we've been able to get, and having access to community gardens is so important. And then we can't forget our mini parks. And thank you, Johanna, and that group that's formed. Because a lot of times we have these spaces that are often forgotten and ignored and can turn into areas that end up being magnets for blight if not maintained in the right way. And so we're going to reclaim those spaces. But just wanted to say a few words here today. Wanted to thank everyone and thank the leadership of folks from my community. Thank to all of you that are active in your parks. Because if anything that we learned during the pandemic is how important our public spaces are, how important our green spaces and open spaces are, and what that meant to our sanity, what it meant to our families, what it meant to our seniors, what it meant to all of those that needed to have access to space so they could recreate and keep their sanity during these hard times. So just wanted to come up and say a few words. Thank you very much to the Parks Alliance for giving me the opportunity. And thank you for all your tremendous work and dedication to all of you.
Thank you, Supervisor. And we couldn't do anything without the deep support of elected officials in our communities, and something we're very proud of is the way that we can help to forge these relationships to make great projects happen. So without further ado, I want to turn it over to this extraordinary group. Good luck with the clicker, guys. Try and point it kind of right at that silver box, and hopefully that will help. First up to present here, Caitlin Galloway from the Greenhouse Project.
Thank you. So the Greenhouse Project is a group that's been working for about 10 years now. We're working in close partnership also with another group called Friends of 770 Woolsey, which is a neighborhood advocacy group out in the Portola. And we are working together around the activation of a particular site, 770 Woolsey, which is out in the Portola district. So we together are putting forward a vision for the site that is a permanent, community-centered working farm for San Francisco, and we're temporarily calling that Portola Farm. So a quick bit of history about the site you're looking at. It's 2.2 acres. It was built in the 1920s by the Garibaldi family as a flower nursery. They grew cut flowers and took them to sell at the market downtown. That operation shuttered in the 90s, and the lot has sat dormant and dilapidating ever since. So it's the last remaining site of what used to be dozens of similar operations in the neighborhood. So this area of the city, the Portola District, was and is still known as San Francisco's Garden District. So there's a lot I could say here, but I'll focus today with why. Why a working farm in the city? So, big picture, to put it really simply, our food systems, I think we all know, are wildly out of balance, to put it mildly. And as they exist now, they are leading, they're kind of major contributors to climate change. So major shifts need to happen, we all know this, and it's going to be all hands on deck to fix this issue for future generations. So shifting toward a more thriving, more kind of locally based, community based food economy is going to be the crucial work of the next couple generations. And one thing I think is really clear, cities are going to have to be a really important part of that. Cities will play a very important role in any solutions that we come up with. Cities are dense, not only in terms of population, increasingly so, but in terms of consumption and also in terms of education. Cities are very potent sites for knowledge and awareness and the propagation of ideas. So we believe that urban agriculture, so bringing a portion of our food production into cities, increasing food systems literacy through this visibility is crucial. So fortunately, what I'm talking about today is 770 Woolsey, which is, I think, one of the city's kind of shining opportunities to move in this direction. So here's some of our neighbors in the Portola. There's widespread support for a community farm at this site in the neighborhood. It's an incredibly galvanizing vision across cultures and across generations throughout the neighborhood. And if you drive around, you'll see some of these yellow "We Support Portola Farm" posters in windows as a pretty striking visual. So just to fast forward to where we are now, the Greenhouse Project and Friends of 770 Woolsey have an option to purchase this property from the current developer. So we're engaged in a capital campaign to exercise this option before our deadline this summer. So I won't go into that in detail, but just to, in brief, momentum is strong. So far, so good. So I'll just wrap up with, just to kind of run you quickly through the concept for the site. The vision is a full working farm for San Francisco. So it includes outdoor farm production, vegetables, flowers, and then indoor rehabilitated greenhouses for vegetables, flowers, and then also for plant starts, so seedlings to kind of propagate out throughout backyards in the city. There'll be a commercial kitchen, farmers market, an outdoor kind of gathering and event space, and then a nod to the site's history throughout the space. So this kind of, what underpins all of this work is the idea that this can be an educational hub for San Franciscans around our food system, a training ground and a space of reverence for agriculture, and a place for connection and for food growing. So I think this really can position San Francisco as part of, a small part of, a much larger and robust and local kind of food shed, which I think is necessary.
Thank you, Caitlin.
Thank you.
We're gonna literally pass the mic down the row here. So what we're gonna hear next from Ann and Leslie representing Bernal Heights Outdoor Cinema.
Sure we will. Okay. Oh, whoop, wrong direction.
Down?
I thought it was the other way. Oh. There we go. Hi, everyone. I'm Ann Botmal. I'm one of the co-founders of Bernal Heights Outdoor Cinema. And we are not park stewards as such, but we are definitely a park-based program. We celebrate the work of local filmmakers' works in our outdoor spaces in Bernal Heights to build and nurture community. In 2004, when we started Bernal Heights Outdoor Cinema, Bernal Heights itself was in the early stages of gentrification. We still had a lot of working class families, and it was still relatively affordable. Leslie and I share a background in film and video, and we knew of several our neighbors involved in that field. And Leslie had the great idea to showcase their work to our neighbors in free screenings. Excuse me. And we figured, why not in the parks? It's a big space, we can get a lot of people there. So we did. We played at Persita Park, we played at Bernal Heights Recreation Center Playground, and Holly Park, with equipment that we borrowed or was donated and we set up ourselves. But once we applied for grants, we realized we needed a fiscal sponsor, and that's how we got on the path to joining the San Francisco Parks Alliance. We started with Friends of Golden Gate Park, but we were more centered on neighborhood parks, so then we joined the Neighborhood Parks Council, which then, as you all know, merged with Friends of Golden Gate Park, and that's where we are today. Sorry. Our past seasons, we added to our programming of outdoor end-of-summer park screenings with a film crawl on Cortland where we show simultaneous screenings in six different venues and small venues indoors and out on Cortland Avenue. We had season openers and finales in various locations around the hill, which included receptions as well as the screenings. And then we have our winter series, which we call the Face-to-Face with the Filmmaker, where we invite a filmmaker to show a longer format film and have Q&A with the audience. The last 2 years, those screenings have been virtual. And our outdoor screenings have been restricted. And which brings us to the present. And I'm going to let Leslie take on from there.
So the slide you saw previously actually represents the innovation that we took on over the last 2 years, courtesy of the coronavirus. So basically, we made the decision to step away from parks due to the ever-changing COVID requirements. And we came up with the idea of creating a pop-up drive-in, not in a park, but in a public space, which was Alamany Plaza, also known as Alamany Farmers Market, which is located on the south slope or the backside of Bernal Heights. Our goal was still to keep it accessible and in the neighborhood and free, which we were able to do using Eventbrite and a limited number of registrations based on a first-come, first-served basis. And we were able to keep everyone safe. So people were obviously in their cars, the cars were appropriately distanced, everyone was masked when they stepped out of their car. And it was a safe environment for our audience, as well as our filmmakers and our volunteer crew. So this is what we deemed South Slope Cinema, which we did for 2 years. And then our next slide actually celebrates our upcoming season. So we are returning to our neighborhood parks. On September 9th, 10th, and the 16th, we are lucky enough to return to Presida Park, which is our traditional night under the stars. We're also making a return to Bernal Playground, which is the neighborhood playground right behind the Bernal Branch Library off of Cortland. And we are still in the process of negotiating a return to Bernal Hill. A number of years ago, we did Bernal Hill, the base of the hill on the north slope at the top of Folsom and Bernal Heights Boulevard. Meanwhile, we continue to do our seasonal challenges of fundraising, as well as promotion and outreach. We still try to expand our reach to all corners of our neighborhood, geographically, ethnically, age, and levels of ableism. And the other goal that we've had for the last couple of years is the idea of trying to create a succession plan. So we'd love to talk with any park partners or other friends after this to hear of your success in trying to create a plan to pass on the organization and keep it healthy after the key volunteers and organizers have stepped away.
Thanks. Thank you so much, Leslie and Ann. So our next group here wins, I think, the award for the longest incredible work in Bernal Heights, right? The longest group name, I actually have to read it because I'm going to fumble on it, but we have Dr. Honeycutt with us to represent the Minnie and Lovey Ward Park Community Rec Council.
Thank you very much, Mr. Winn, and I know he's watching the three-minute clock when it comes to me, so I will move very quickly through this. He's trying to hide, but I know he's there.
I can jump in whenever I want.
I know you can, and that's what I'm afraid of, okay? I am the chair of the Community Recreation Council, CRC, for the Minnie and Lovey Ward Park. I want to introduce you to two of the real movers and shakers of the Minnie and Lovey Ward CRG, and that is Al and Mary Harris. Raise your hands. I want them to see you. All right. Now, we all know on our CRG that we stand on the shoulders of Minnie Ward, an outstanding African-American female activist who fought for her community, and she fought. She passed away suffering from cancer, but in the time when she was alive, she fought drug dealers, she fought gangs and criminals to better the OMI community. And it was, she worked hard to get the OMI where it is today. I remember moving into the neighborhood in 74. There was a time where I could not even walk my dog in the park. That's how dangerous it was, okay? But people like Al and Mary fought hard to make sure that that park is what it is today. So I want to, and I know Mr. Wynn's going to get me for this afterwards too. I want to thank this SFPA for their partnership with us and the tremendous support they lent to our project. I want to, and we are very grateful to our marvelous supervisor, district supervisor, Asha Safayi, for giving our project $50,000 so that we could bring this all to fruition. And I'm very grateful to Mei Ling for providing, Yui, for providing additional support for our project. And also grateful for Jennifer Hom and Mei Ling, Yui, and Kathleen Butler for the coordination of our project. Okay, what was our vision? Our vision, and I'm going to use it in my vernacular, we wanted to complete the last raggedy part of the park, you know, because the rest was beautiful, you know, the artificial turf. And by the way, I live a block away from the park, so I am delighted when I hear these young people primarily yelling at the top of their voices as they are in their soccer games. And nothing gives me more delight than to hear their voices. Now, most people say, well, how can you put up with that noise? I love it. Yell on, okay? And I mean it. So we wanted to take this last little piece of land, and it's at Capitol and Plymouth, right at the top. Okay, and I noticed that people would go in there and they would garden. And I said, you know, that looks so bad. My God, can we do something? The rest of the park is beautiful, but this garden area is not together. So what we wanted to do is to do this extensive work to complete this part of the park so that it would be beautiful for the community members and the public, so they'd have a place where they could grow plants and in a beautiful setting, okay? The benefits to the community, joy in abundance, and I mean that. The revitalized garden is a place where our diverse community members can enjoy each other and escape from the issues of everyday life. The garden is a place where people are assigned a garden plot so they can grow what appeals to them. Some people grow food so that they can eat. A lady who runs a childcare center brings her children to the center, and I asked her, please, just do this for me. Help those young people to not say this when I ask them where food comes from initially. Please don't tell me, have them tell me that it comes from Safeway. That's all I ask, okay? We know you get it at Safeway, but where does it come from? And so what she does is she brings the young people over so they can plant and enjoy gardening. The garden, there's another benefit too to the garden that I hadn't thought about until I talked to my eldest grandson, that the garden provides more foot traffic and people in the park, and more foot traffic ultimately cuts down on crime and deters folks from committing crimes in our park. And I hadn't thought about that, but I thought I would share that with you. Oh, put this up like this. Okay, I'm sorry.
He's short on time. Wrap it up.
Oh, is that what he's saying? Oh, okay. Okay, well, gee.
Okay, no, I just threw Niels under the bus. Sorry. Okay. Continue, Dr. Honeycutt.
Okay, I'm wrapping it up, Mr. Winn. Didn't I tell you he was going to stay on top of me? Okay, so finally, the park will enable us to host other community events and will draw even more people to the Minnie and Lovey Ward Park. Please drop by if you have the opportunity when your time permits, and thank you for allowing me to share information about our park.
Thank you so much, Dr. Honeycutt. And if it seems cruel to ask our presenters to go so quickly, know that everybody will be here for the reception, and I'm hoping we can have a wonderful conversation with some beers where we can dig deeper into all of their projects. We know them as the Lindas, Linda L. and Linda D., Friends of the AMP. Take it away.
Hi. Thank you so much for inviting us to be here. Friends of the AMP, the Jerry Garcia Amphitheater, that is really all about friends. My friend and I, for 25 years, have been extolling the virtues of McLaren Park. And at the time we met, this was a park that was totally ignored, or at least on our side, the Excelsior side, it was looking pretty shabby. And it also had a fear factor. People didn't go into the park. And because of that, this lack of foot traffic, this lack of engagement, it became more withered and ignored. And so what we realized is we needed to engage our neighbors in discovering this incredibly beautiful, valuable piece of open space in San Francisco. So we learned about the Friends of McLaren Park, but they were positioned primarily on the other side of the park in the Portola area. And so we joined forces with them. We tried to create a 360-degree view of the park, all sides of it, Visitation Avenue and the Crocker Amazon side of the park, and get the people together. And then we decided to see if we could do something about the very ignored Jerry Garcia Amphitheater as well. And so that was our next endeavor, to try to bring people together to work on this space. We did that by lots of advocating and helped get it a very iconic name, and that helped a little. And then try to get entertainment producers to take a look about hosting their next event there. And when they didn't come around real quickly, we looked at each other and we said, well, we're just going to show them how to do it.
That's right. And by the way, that amphitheater was called the Amphitheater. So we had to get a name, and we had to work on that. But I'm going to talk a little bit about where we went from that. We had to create a docent program, which was an all-volunteer way to bring everyone around that felt that because the park had been underutilized, it might present both a safety factor, and also the park people needed to know who was going to be running the shows if we were to put them on. And also we wanted to have a great customer experience. So we created a docent program. We walked around and checked out the park and actually sketched it out. We met with SF Safe. We met with the Ingleside police captain and his permits officer. We met with Park Patrol. We had to have our supervisor meet also. And then we also employed the really good support of Castro Community Patrol. They showed us the ropes because they seemed to know what they're doing. And we set up a wonderful docent program. And Linda is demonstrating all of the outfits that we had. And and we engaged the community. And it was really a wonderful opportunity for us to make sure that people knew where the park was. For example, when Uber and Lyft came into being, they didn't know where the park was, so it couldn't drop anybody off. We had to find out and let the bus people know where to drop people off. We had signage issues. Backstage, we had to figure out where load-in and load-out was going to occur. And for ADA parking, we had to make sure we had people in the parking lots so that they could direct people how to get up to the amphitheater. And really developed a program that over time has now become a model for Reckon Park. So we're very happy about that.
Thank you, Lindas. Yeah. Do you have any last, hit it quickly on this one and then we'll move along.
Thanks. I have, so when 2020 rolled around, the amphitheater went dark for two reasons, COVID and then construction. And there's lots of new capital improvements, which are going to increase traffic there in the future. So our role will transition now more to mentoring and technical expertise, as well as helping new folks who want to rent the amphitheater through Rec and Parks Reservations Department and how to do it. And we look at producing a really vibrant website where we can let everyone know throughout the city what's happening at the amphitheater and promote the events. So that's how we see our future, and we're so excited to have been in park partners since 2014, or 2010, with the Parks Alliance, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Linda. So next up, we have Jenny Weber, who's going to tell us about the ECOS SF project. I'm going to click for you guys over there because I don't think it's going to work for you, so just give me a nod and I'll do your next slide.
Thank you. This is great to be here, and if a little nerve-wracking, I've barely spoken at a dining room table, let alone in front of a bunch of people. So I do have it written out because I took the 3 minutes very seriously, so it's also a crutch. But In 2015, I began to befriend the wonderful and resilient community of Visitation Valley while working as a landscape architect. I'm designing a public green schoolyard at Visitation Valley Elementary School, which is affectionately known as Little Viz. And at that time, I hadn't been in the valley much, and I haven't been throughout the city and seen many, many schoolyards and communities. I was really upset to see the condition of that school and the neighborhood around it, especially when it went into further area, into like Sunnydale. It was very upsetting to see the dirty sidewalks, the hazardous conditions at the school, the dirty school. It was filthy inside in areas. And also the park that was empty. Though a lot of work had been done in the community, it was really sad that a park, a big playground, which was adjacent to the school, was devoid of the sound of children's laughter. So knowing how much our daily environment impacts our health, our outlook, our academic achievement, and even one's life expectancy, we saw an essential need to improve the growing conditions for the children and underserved community. We decided to leverage the work we are doing at the school and join with the Greater Valley community and activists in creating more beautiful, regenerative, life-enhancing public spaces. And we have Fran Martin here and Ann Seaman, who've done a lot of work in the valley. At one point, it was a very dangerous area, and it's improved now, but still the danger continues. So, through city grants, we had the opportunity to get to know many people and organizations and activists in the community and to learn about their lives and the work that they were doing, social and ecological justice work that they were doing in the valley. We discussed the challenges they face daily in the community with systemic racism, generational poverty, lack of recreational and job opportunities, violence, fear, and trauma inform the fabric of daily existence and in which they're working to fulfill their dreams, raise healthy, happy children, contribute to society, and build community. And you can see some of the work that we did through the grant work. We got a CCG Art and Public Space grant, and the work of Colette Crutcher and Eileen Barr did some beautiful mosaic work. And we are working now on doing greening at the schools. Planting trees is our next big step we're doing with a capital project. And then we also did a lot of, as they said earlier this morning, interim activation, because we realized that so many people have done so many studies in the valley, but what's really happening on a daily basis and how can we enrich the community now? So we worked with the Boys and Girls Club and did a team building event with a professional team builder. And we did Easter event, and then Let's Go to Our Park event, which was funded by participatory budget from the District 10. And that was a big event. Linda gave me some advice on how to do that, having never thrown an event like that ever. And then also now we're working with the Park Service, speaking with them on a daily basis, a weekly basis, no, bi-weekly basis. And we now have soccer programming coming through the, there now at the park, which we're very excited for, and they're committed to next year as well. So, but sadly, it took a great tragedy to gain real momentum with our work. Next one. In January of 2019, while exercising at dawn in Visitation Valley Playground across the street from her home, a beloved community elder, Grandmother Yikoi Huang, was violently assaulted by a Valley youth, and she passed on a year later from the severe injuries she suffered. Choosing love over revenge, her granddaughter Susanna Yi called out through tears for peace in the Southeast, turning pain into purpose. And Susanna sits with us right now. And she's done so much work. We have joined with Susanna as the Abundant Love Team in 2 years of community engagement discussing renaming Visitation Valley as Yikoi Huang Peace and Friendship Park. Memorializing Grandmother Huang's remarkable life, a working class immigrant from China with 2 years of education, who worked tirelessly to become a US citizen and contribute generously to society. Her life and achievements epitomize the lives of so many migrants and immigrants who have made the Valley their home. This past Thursday, the Working Committee of SFRP voted unanimously to rename the playground as Yikoi Huang Peace and Friendship Park. And this is a positive step towards healing in the community and shining light on the need for investing in restoring the social fabric of the neighborhood. Our work in the Valley is to create healthy community growing conditions by further renovating and further activating public spaces, thus fostering well-being and belonging and facilitating multicultural, multiracial, and intergenerational friendships between neighbors. So through participatory design, we have developed a vision plan for the park and school with elements supporting safety, play, health, socializing, and career development. And as CJ so eloquently said today, elevating the beloved society. And there are all these known activities and benefits you can bring that bring so much. It's like evidence-based design. And to see the playground devoid when it's such a beautiful big piece of real estate that is empty and unoccupied. I've been by there probably 40 times, and you barely see anyone in the park. And it's one of the most dense areas in the city for children. And there's something wrong with that, seriously wrong with that. So currently we're fundraising for the school greening and for a lucky climber symbolizing Yikoi Huang's loving, cheerful spirit.
Thank you, Jenny.
Thank you.
We're going to pass it along now to Doug Jacuzzi, who's representing the Far Out West Community Guard.
Hello, I hope you don't mind if I stand.
Go for it.
I can see my slides a little more easily. I don't know what the order of these will come up in, but that's fine. The fantastic histories we've heard from the panel up here today are great. This is a very small piece of property that's a side yard of a church that is south-facing to a main street, Judah Street, out in the outer Sunset, and everybody knows how difficult it is to grow anything out near the beach. I walked by this side yard for many years on my morning walk to my office, and I witnessed the church's yard go from a somewhat kept space to a barely kept space to an unkept space to basically an urban blight that was cut off from the public by a cyclone fence and became basically a public dumping ground, which was upsetting because with farming in my background with my family and growing up, growing things in our yard, that south-facing exposure was just torture for me to watch go fallow and unkept. After a couple of years of grinding on the church directorship, I was able to convince them, and after asking around in the community, what would it take to just let the community try and keep your space for you. With the new directorship at the church, was given the thumbs up to go ahead and take the cyclone fence down, jackhammer out much of the concrete, and form a community garden, of which now is the Far Out West Community Garden. And that was 10 years ago. We are at our 10-year anniversary, and in 2013, we joined with the Parks Alliance, and the Parks Alliance has been hugely helpful, so big shout out to the Parks Alliance, of course, why we're all here. After this brief history, I'd like to just touch base on the elements of our park, and a nod to the shift. Okay. Hold it right there then. We have, of course, we have three primary elements to our park. Of course, there's the garden elements that you just saw, and we have both our plot holders. Our next element, which is our mural element, that shout out to Erica and our neighbor building next door, who donated her the facade of her three-story building for a wonderful Green New Deal mural, of which hopefully you all saw the film, or many of you hopefully saw the film during the lunch break here today. Our third element is an educational element. We encourage groups to come and use the garden, use the grounds for just basically primarily for youth to get their hands into the dirt, get dirty, and learn whatever they can about being in a garden environment rather than in apartments or in their schoolyards. And some of the schoolyards don't have a lot of garden space, although that, since we've started Far Out West, fortunately, seen a lot of our Unified School District's school grounds also come up in garden spaces. So those are our three primary elements. And then lastly, I'd like to just close by saying that even though this is a small patch of land in our urban environment, it is incredibly meaningful to the community, and in such way that not a day goes by where if I'm in the garden, or if one of our other garden members' garden, that somebody doesn't come by and discover and ask and stop and come into the garden and ask how they can become involved. And so, and we could, I could stand here in soapbox, but you've all now are, oh, she wants me, okay. She's reminding me too. Would you mind going back one slide? I'm trying to stuff it all in my 3 minutes. I forgot a very important part of our garden is our water catchment system, and you'll see the 1,800 gallon stainless steel tank in the background. And thank you, Erica, for pointing this out. This is an important element to our garden in that it is the first at-scale groundwater recharge system paid for by the San Francisco PUC, and of which was a pilot project for Westside Water Resources, which is moving through the city and transitioning properties from sewer-connected stormwater to groundwater recharge. Everybody remember that, Westside Water Resources. Okay, thank you.
Thank you,
okay,
Doug.
I'll pass the microphone on. Thanks, Erica.
And two more groups to go here. Thanks for sticking with us, and thank you to everybody for trying your best to do 3 minutes. I know it's almost impossible when you care about your work. Friends of OMI Mini Parks, Johanna.
Thank you. Okay, I didn't know what order the slides would be in either. Okay, well, first let me just start by saying I feel so inspired by being around all of you up here today and everyone that does this kind of work, and it makes me feel hopeful because it's been a little bit of a journey to get to where we are today. So I initially started like on Nextdoor, like of all places, finding other neighbors that felt the same way. You know, seeing things in the community, in the OMI, where we are, that we weren't exactly excited about, right? And that was right around the start of the pandemic when I was spending more time at home like everyone else and getting out and walking and doing the Crosstown Trail. Shout out to my friends over there, the Crosstown Trail. And doing walks in my neighborhood and walking by and like wondering, why is this park empty and blighted? This is the Randolph-Bright Mini Park, and it's on the Randolph Corridor. Behind this crowd of lovely volunteers, you'll see in the very front was our police captain from the Taravol Station, which is amazing. He came out with his own picker and sweeper that day and cleaned up the streets with us, as well as my partner in crime on the steering committee, Maurice Rivers from OMI CPP, and the librarian from the Ocean View branch. Mission Housing brought tons of people out. I'm sure I'm forgetting people, but there were a lot of people that stood in that space with me and saw what I saw and said, yeah, we can do better. Oh, actually, EJ in the back from our D11 office. D11. So this lovely outdated sandbox behind you has all kinds of hidden treasures in it. And there's a very unsafe and undesirable play structure behind it. And what you can't see in front of us is a super uneven with invasive weeds sort of lump that could be a nice grassy area where we could gather, where children could gather and picnic, and you know, our seniors that we have a lot of, in addition to families and young people, could gather and you know, make this a community space. Parks are a public good. So in our supervisor Asai's words, yeah, we're going to renovate it and rehabilitate it and return it to our community for its intended purpose, where we can gather, where we can have community events, and where people can enjoy that space. This is the Lakeview Ashton Mini Park. It's one of our beautiful green spaces in the OMI. Hidden secret, one of the best views in the city. We don't want anyone to know, so don't tell anyone out of this room. But we started a cleanup before I actually joined the Community Partner Network, just slightly before. Aligning with other neighbors that felt the same way. There's beautiful native flora and fauna and butterflies when they're in season, and this fantastic view. And these are some of one of my other partners on the steering committee, Mandy, and other neighbors that just came out and said, yeah, we want to clean this up. So the natural space department from Parks and Rec came out and we cleaned it up, and we talked about the potential of education program and planting and all of that good stuff. I love that you're just like moving me along. That's okay. I was getting there. And this is the last one, because I don't just do one park, you know, I have to do three. We don't have like movie theaters or farms or, you know, amphitheaters, but we've got heart and we've got three parks that we're gonna clean up. So this is the Brotherhood Head Mini Park. As you can see, the ground cover is really uneven and bad, and the play structure is outdated, and our basketball court could use some love and some lighting. We could use lighting at all these places. So that's what we hope to do. Is we've started community cleanups. We've started talking about programming. We're fundraising. I'll have my hat outside to pass around if you want to put some money in it afterwards. Just kidding. Not really. but yeah, that's what this is about, right? OMI Pride. We are full of heart there, and we will return these parks to the community, these green spaces to the community, and I'm really excited to be here and grateful to be amongst all these wonderful people.
Thank you, Johanna. And what she didn't mention is that it's one of our new class of groups that just signed their fiscal
That's
sponsorship
true.
Agreements about less than 2 months ago.
Dry, yeah.
So just getting started.
Here.
So to bring us home, Brian Springfield, Friends of Harvey Milk Plaza.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brian Springfield. I am the executive director of the Friends of Harvey Milk Plaza. Our project is located at the intersection of Castro and Market Streets in the geographic center of the city. This is there is something that is already there that is named Harvey Milk Plaza, but what is there now was actually built as the entrance to the new Castro Muni Station when it came online in 1980. So it wasn't until 1985 that it was community named for Harvey Milk, and it's really suffered since then trying to live up to its namesake, and the community's been talking about doing something to better represent who Harvey was and his significance to the community since then. So this rendering shows the design proposal, and you notice what many people think of as Harvey Milk Plaza is just half of the site. The site extends from Castro Street all the way to Collingwood Street, and at the other end is, we call it the imprisoned garden. It's a garden space that's been fenced off, and then there's a fence around the fence, which confuses me. But we want to create gathering space for the community where there is none. We obviously don't want to do anything to compromise the function of the transit station below and access to that station, and then we want to create occupiable park space at the other end of the site. Next slide. Thanks. So this is the corner closest to the Castro and Market intersection. And down there at the lower left is a quote by feminist author Grace Paley, "The only recognizable feature of hope is action." And that quote was gifted to the project by photographer Danny Nicoletta. Danny actually worked at Castro Camera. He was a friend of Harvey Milk's. He took that famous photo of Harvey with his blowing necktie that you all may have seen before. And Harvey, Danny felt that this quote was the complement to Harvey's famous quote about you've got to give him hope. Because hope is something you carry around inside of you, but action is what you do to manifest that hope into change. And so this sort of wedding cake feature at the corner here is called the pedestal. And on top of that is a medallion that has the word act in it. And this will function as a stage during gatherings or functions, informal or planned, that happen at the corner. But it's also a reference to a traditional statue where you see the base of a statue and then you see usually a bronze figure of somebody on top of that. But the people on top of this pedestal are the community and the activism that is still going on. And next slide is the complement to that. At the other end of the site that is really sort of quiet in character and neighborhood and scale, there's like a more intimately scaled space, and another medallion has the word hope on it. And this is to invite introspection on the idea of hope, which is, as I mentioned, something we carry around inside of our hearts. It's probably the part of Harvey's story that connects to many of us very deeply. And so we are still in the planning stages here. We are in the process of developing an MOU with the city, and then we'll work with existing community partners who have programmatic focuses on equity to work on activating the space and making it come alive with the mission that Harvey was part of, but that continues on today.
Thank you so much, Brian. And our three-minute presentation award winner, I think, as well. So can we have a huge round of applause for all of these extraordinary groups? What an inspiring work. And I know that we're all eager to eat and have a drink. I certainly am. But I just want to take 1 second to make one last point that the groups have really already made on their own. Many of you may have noticed last year that we formally renamed this program within the Parks Alliance, our fiscal sponsorship program, the Community Partner Network. And there's a lot of intention behind that, because what we see as perhaps the biggest opportunity amongst all of us that are here today and many partners who weren't able to attend is the promise of connecting peers more closely with one another. The way that the incredible lived experience, institutional knowledge, wisdom, know-how, passion, tricks, tips, and fellowship that is evident on the stage, and I think has been evident here throughout the day, is a resource that we need to mine more deeply. And it's one that the Parks Alliance is committed to figuring out how we can play our role as a backbone organization to all of the partners that we work with, whether we provide them with fiscal sponsorship or not, to help elevate this work of community-based stewards of public space throughout the city of San Francisco. And I think, you know, for me, I'm so thrilled we were able to put this panel together, because I think this group, you know, representing about a tenth of the 90 groups that we do provide fiscal sponsorship to, gives a sense of the tip of the iceberg here of how much knowledge, how much pure knowledge experience is out there that we need to be sharing more effectively with one another. And that I think, you know, something that one of the participants in the Shine On panel said is that she feels really alone sometimes at the beginning of a project. It can be hard to get your neighbors interested in what you're doing. But there are people here who have tried to do similar things in other parts of the city, who know how that feels and know how to get to the other side of it. And so just know, you know, however you're working with the Parks Alliance today and going forward, that this is a big part of our intention going forward. You're going to be seeing an expanded programs in the coming years that all have this idea of how can we strengthen the connection between peers? How can we make sure that the knowledge that each one of these groups has is shared effectively amongst the groups, and that we can all support each other? Because the reality is that this human network is the linchpin of the physical network. and no public space in San Francisco is going to be as great as it can be in isolation. Everything is connected, and everything is going to elevate everything else. And so I just want to applaud the people behind that work. We've seen a percentage of them here today. And I'm personally so inspired to get to continue that work with all of them and all of you moving forward. And so without further ado, this is one of my favorite images from the time that I've spent working in the Parks Alliance. Group of neighbors who came together as part of our Moss Metamorphosis project, and just feeling how joyful and how unique a space can be with a little bit of creativity and a little bit of wherewithal to say, you know, the street in SoMa could be a place where we could have a community celebration that feels this authentic and this real and this meaningful, and where a lot of different people can come together. And I think, you know, the 8 projects that we've heard about this afternoon are very representative of that same spirit in their own way. So thank you to all of you. Thank you to everybody who participated today. This is the last session. And please mix, mingle, share your knowledge, share your phone numbers and email addresses, tell people about your projects, talk to the people that presented on stage tonight, go up to them and anybody else that you heard from, and help us start to share this wealth of important experience and knowledge amongst ourselves going forward to make San Francisco continue to be the best expression of what it is in its public spaces throughout the whole city. So food, drinks, fun, and people are outside. Thank you, everybody, for participating. And thank you to the rest of the Parks Alliance staff for making this day such a success.